What an incredible team. I mean, all week long. Listen, some of you noticed the bags down in front. One of the things that we've taught the students all week long is to live outside yourself. And we have a team leaving in a couple of weeks to Haiti, and these are going to go to an orphanage in Haiti to all the orphans that we support there. Isn't that wonderful? Teaching them how to live outside, school supplies, different school supplies, as well as a Bible lesson plan that our second year internship program students will be going and doing the Bible lesson plan with them. Now listen, that whole thing that you saw was about joy. We talked about managing our emotions all week long. Now we're going to be joyful of this. I want you to see this. There were over 650 first through fifth graders that registered for Inside Out Camp. Woo! Isn't that awesome? Listen. We had over 150 volunteers each day helping. We had an average of 575 kids attend all week long. And here's the biggest one that I want to give a big shout for, 241 decisions to follow Jesus. Isn't that awesome? Listen, and what that means is you can begin the dialogue in your house about what it means to know that you are loved, accepted, right where you are by the only God, Jesus, in America. Amen? I love that. Now listen, what I want to talk about for just a few minutes, it might be different for you to have your children in here. Don't worry about it. They don't stress me out in here. They shouldn't stress you out, all right? Listen, I want to talk about what the Bible says and how the Bible describes joy. About what it means to be joyful, about what it means in each and every day for each of us to choose joy. I just want to look at a couple of scriptures and see. So look at this. The psalmist David here is talking, and he talks about joy, and he says this, "The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him." And he says, "And he helps me, and my heart leaps for joy." Now, I don't know about you, but my heart generally stays in this area right about right here. It doesn't really leap. And it's almost like he has a hard time describing joy. He almost has a difficult time. And he says, it's just that my heart leaps for joy. It's one of those things, you can almost, when you're joyful, it's almost like you have to tell people. It's almost like you have to celebrate with people. It's almost like you have to share it with people. It's almost, David talks about joy maybe not being contained. And it's hard to put a picture to it, but maybe something like this. Like, oh, yeah. Yeah, a couple of games short. Watch out next year. That's all I'm going to say. I mean, just things like this. It's like when you're joyful, it's just things, it's like you have to share it. When you're joyful, it's David, the psalmist, joy, it's like my heart leaps. There's something inside that when I'm joyful, I want to share it. When there's good news, I want to share it with people. I want to celebrate with other people. It's almost like I can't contain. The Bible describes joy where it's just hard to contain. You share it with people. Have you ever been to a game where you score a great goal or someone hits a home run at the right time or a touchdown? Thank God, Lord, we pray for the Bucks right now. Pray for the Bucks this year. It's like you hug, you high-five people you don't even really know. If you're really joyful, you just might smack a kiss on them or something. Who knows? But David says, my heart leaps for joy. Joy in the Bible is described as this emotion that you have to share, that you experience with others. I love this. Let me hear joy. David, it's almost like a prayer. He says, let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that have been broken. Immediately, what you see in Scripture is the authors putting alongside hurt or pain or something that we've been through. Another emotion, depression, angst, anger, alongside joy. But it's almost David here is almost asking like a prayer, let me hear joy. Let me hear joy in the midst of my bones being hurt. It's a very biblical way, very Hebrew way of saying hurt and pain. There's been hurt and pain. So, Lord, I'm praying, let me hear joy. Let me hear gladness and joy. And what we should be thinking about when we read a scripture like that is there has been times when you and I have been hurt by someone or something, and it's robbed us of our joy. But the scriptures say you should pray, because David says, let me hear, praying to the Lord, let me hear joy and gladness. So not only is joy something you celebrate and share that can't be contained, joy has to be expressed. But joy is something also you can pray for in the midst of bones being broken, in the midst of hurt and pain. The Lord wants us to pray for joy. I love this scripture. You turn my wailing into dancing, and you remove my sackcloth and clothe me. It's now all of a sudden joy is something that you put on. A very Jewish way. I was in sackcloth, something wearing. I was in something that was depressing or like sadness. So you've turned one action and one behavior, a downtrodden mental state. Some would even call it depressed. I sometimes call it, I feel like I'm not in a good rhythm. I'm feeling a little off. And now that the author here says, but what you've done, God, is you've turned my wailing, this state of mind, into another state of mind, into dancing. I was clothed at one time, I was clothed with sackcloth, which is a very biblical way of mourning and down. It was to express being down and depressed. And you've taken this mentality, this space that I've had, and what you've done is you've turned it. You've now clothed me. You've put on me. So no matter what's being said or done to me, not like we ignore other emotions, sadness or anger, or sometimes even fear. We don't ignore them. But at the end of the day, I'm clothed in joy. At the end of the day, I'm going to be joyful, because no matter what is put on me, sackcloth in this case, but no matter what is put on me, I am no matter what clothed in joy, because you've taken my wailing and you've turned it into dancing. So the Lord has the ability, according to Scripture, to move our emotions when we ask, when we're honest and real, authentic with Him, whether it's anger, angst, sadness, fear, to turn it. It's like clothing. It's almost like, you know, I wear joy, not oblivious. I think if we're honest, if we meet people like that in our life who are just always happy and smiling, don't you just sometimes just want to, like, really? Seriously? Don't you want to just, well, really? The Bible is very clear that it's not that we stick our head in the sand and ignore the realities of what life can bring us. And I think if you watch the news enough, or you tune into the right stations enough, there can be a ton of things that we hear about that can create sadness. Wouldn't you agree? But the scriptures say, no, you don't ignore those. What happens is you're clothed. I clothe you in joy. That even though we have to deal with the sadness or the angst or these other different emotions, fear, that we still are clothed in joy. The author here wants you to know that it can turn, because at the end of the day, no matter what happens, I'm clothed in joy. I love this. The Apostle Paul speaking here, he says a great scripture. He says to the church there, you become imitators of us. You've watched what we've said and done while we've talked to you about God. He says, you become imitators of us and of the Lord. For you welcome the message, the good news, that right where you are, you're loved. Right where you are, God wants to meet you. Right where you are worthy of His forgiveness, grace, and mercy because of the cross and resurrection right where you are. Welcome the message. In the midst of severe, what's that word? Suffering. It's interesting that scripture, this is why here at the chapel we say all the time, the Bible's the compass. The Bible's the compass. The Bible, every word that is there is supposed to be there. Every word that's not supposed to be there is not supposed to be there. It's perfect. It's interesting here That the Bible doesn't treat joy like you're to ignore all of your other emotions and just walk around like shiny, happy people. I'm a Christian and I love God and I've got no problems. It's actually the opposite. Paul speaking here, it says, you have welcomed our message in the midst of great suffering. So apparently, you can still have joy in the middle of hurt and pain and severe suffering. Apparently, you can't just have one thing, one emotion going on. Will you ignore all the rest? According to Scripture, you can be in the middle of a pain or a hurt, severe suffering, and still be joyful. So it's interesting when we look at the Scriptures, what joy really is. What joy is saying, what the Scriptures say about joy is, man, you can pray for joy. You can turn one emotion into joy. You can have joy in the middle of hurt and pain. You can pray for joy. I love this. The author here. The whole earth is filled with awe at your wonders. Talking about God. The whole earth is at awe with your wonders. Where morning dawns and where evening fades. Where is that, by the way? Where is where morning dawns? What city is that in? What state is that in? Where morning dawns, is that in Connecticut somewhere? We know it's not in Boston because we like nothing about Boston at this church. Just know that, all right? Where morning dawns, where evening fades. That's everywhere, isn't it? Where morning dawns, it's everywhere. Where evening fades is everywhere. It's a very biblical way of saying everywhere. Everywhere, where the whole earth is filled in awe with what you've done, God. The whole earth, where morning dawns and evening fades, everywhere, you call forth songs of joy. Apparently, joy is something, listen, to be observed. Joy, apparently, is a deliberate effort and a conscious effort to look for joy where morning dawns and evening fades. According to Scripture, joy is not only something you pray for, not only something you ask about, not only something that has to be celebrated and experienced, not only something that you share, but according to Scripture, joy is about an awareness of the things around you. Joy, according to the Bible, is a deliberate effort made to find joy everywhere. It's to find joy in everything. What we find in Scripture, the word joy comes from the Greek word keros, which actually means gift. Joy is a gift. Maybe this is why David asked and prayed for it in the middle of his bones being crushed. It's because he needed this gift that can come from God that we think a lot of times God withholds from us because we haven't said the right thing, we haven't done the right thing. It's not true. According to Scripture, joy is everywhere. But it takes an ability to notice, to point to single out, to be conscious and present enough to appreciate it and to know it. I love this. 1 John talks about joy in the most peculiar way. It says, we have seen and heard, and we proclaim also to you all the things that we've seen about Jesus. All the things that we've heard about Jesus, we're telling you now. So that to you too may have fellowship, that you would relate to us, you would know where we're coming from. That you would have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with God because we have a relationship with God. We're sharing these things with you, so we want you to have a relationship with God too. And with his son, Jesus. So I'm writing this letter. Catch it. It's fascinating. So I'm writing these things about the things that I've seen Jesus do and the things that I know he has said. I'm writing these things so that our what? Joy may be complete. So I'm writing this book, John says. I'm writing this book so that you would know about the things that we have seen with Jesus and we have heard about Jesus. But I'm writing this book so that my joy may be what? Complete. So apparently joy is something you do to be complete. The word complete there actually means to be full, to be whole. Apparently, according to John, he has to do something. He has to do something for his joy to be complete. It just doesn't happen. He just doesn't wake up with a gigantic smile. Sometimes he just doesn't go to bed with a gigantic smile. For John, he has to write. He has to do something for his joy to be complete. I've shared this before with many people. A lot of times, whether it's pressure of work, being a father, being a husband, figuring out how to pay for college for my kids, whatever it is, sometimes I'll sink when I think too much of things and how things are going to work, how things are going to happen, how am I going to make this happen, how can I do this, how can I do that? Lord, I'm praying, but I don't really hear anything right now, so I keep praying. In the midst of just going, I can get down. I can feel overwhelmed. I can feel like it's a little like, it's like a little pressure, the pressure. I think if we're honest, we all get that way sometimes. And what I will do, this might sound bad, don't send me emails. If you're a first time guest here, don't send me emails, all right? Listen. What I'll do is I'll find somebody that's worse off than me. And I'll try to help them based on this principle. Because according to John, what we learn from God's word is we don't ignore emotions. We choose joy. We don't ignore situations or circumstances, but we choose joy. We don't ignore all the other things. We choose joy. But in John's scripture here, he says, to make my joy complete, full. Some of us are full of other stuff. We need to be full of joy. And according to be full of joy, I need to go do something. Some of us suffer from being down or depressed. And I'll speak for me. It's because we don't live outside of ourselves. We just live inside ourselves. We have to live outside. According to Scripture, if you are a believer and a follower of Christ, your concentric circles should be going outward, not inward. Some of us believe because we don't say the right things, do the right things, have made mistakes, continue to make mistakes, we struggle. We struggle with appetites and cravings. We struggle with so many things. We think God doesn't want to use us. Well, according to Scripture, you're the very one he does. That's how I got to be your pastor. Aren't you lucky? So anyway, look. According to John, I have to do something for my joy to be complete. It requires some level of action, some level of movement for the things of the kingdom, for the things of God. I'm writing this letter to tell you all about all the things that I've heard God, Jesus say. I'm writing these things to you, this book, to show you, to tell you about the things I've heard and seen him do, the things that move the kingdom of God forward for some of us to get out of our sadness, our anger, our depression, all of to get out of those emotions and jump into joy. We need to do something to move God's kingdom forward, according to Scripture. Because I'm writing this, I'm doing something. So joy, man, you can be clothed in joy. You can pray and ask for joy. Joy is something that is to be shared and to be celebrated. It's not void, like life doesn't have issues and problems. No. Hey, can I tell you this? Can I tell you one joy killer? And I'm sharing this from experience. One, can I just give you what kills joy like that? There's several of them, but one, boom, just kills it. Ungratefulness. It's ungratefulness. Where does ungratefulness come from? It's when we're more focused on what we want than what we have. It's when we're just focused on, I can't get that job. I can't get that position. I don't got kids like that. I don't got parents like that. I ain't got grandparents like that. I don't got an uncle like that. I don't have a wife like that. I don't have a husband like that. Look at that guy. Look at him. Look at how good she treats him. Look at those kids. They're perfect. They act so great. Listen, those kids are in therapy. Love on your kids right where they are. Trust me. It's what ungratefulness starts to take hold of our life when we're more focused on what we don't, what we want, what we desire. There's nothing wrong with wanting more and desiring more. Just as long as it doesn't take the place of appreciating what we have. And ungratefulness comes in, it zaps our joy. It zaps our joy. Listen, we have had an incredible day camp week. It's just amazing. It's amazing what God has done at this church. We just started year 5, guys. It's amazing. It's amazing. But because of my personality, let me just share something with you. Because of my personality, I have already a list of 25 things I know we can do better next year. But if I'm not careful, I don't see the win of over 240 decisions for Jesus. I don't see the win at equipping a whole orphanage with school supplies and biblical lessons. If I'm not careful to celebrate joy, celebrate, share. If I'm not careful to celebrate what I have, what we have in the kingdom, what we have at this church, I will begin to focus on what I don't have. I become ungrateful because I think it has to do with me and not God. And all of a sudden, I'm not joyful. I'm depressed, angry, or sad. Now, joy says, no, don't ignore those feelings. Choose joy. So how do we do that? Simple. I'm asking God to help me to be joyful today. You and I, how do we get joyful? Pastor Q, I'm in this state, I got this situation. It's bringing me down, it's bumming me out. According to scripture, let me hear joy, David says. Let me hear it. Let me hear joy and gladness in the midst of these bones being crushed. In the midst of the thing that might be dragging us down, God's word says, ask me. God's word says, ask me for joy. So that's what we're going to do. Choosing joy, I'm asking God to help me to be joyful. It's the next thing I'm doing. In the middle of difficulty, in the middle of the situation that I'm in, according to scripture, you've received this message, Paul, the author, writing to a church. You've received this message in the midst of severe suffering. You've received it with joy. So in the midst of any difficulty that I'm going through, I'm asking God, let me see the good. Let me see the good. Let me see the light at the end of the tunnel. Let me see the good in what's going on. Because I don't want to be ungrateful, because that's a joy killer. This is difficult. This is hard. This situation stinks. But because I know you love me and I know you care for me, and I know that I have your power and your strength and your love and your grace and mercy right where I am, listen, in the middle of this, I need to ask, help me be joyful. Help me be joyful. And then what I'm going to do, I write these things to you, John says, so that my joy may complete. What does that mean for us? What's the next right thing for you? Just tell me what the next right thing is for you. For a lot of us, it's different for every one of us. What is the next right thing? I write these things about what I've seen Jesus do and what I know he has said. I'm writing you this letter so that my joy may be complete. I need to do something. Joy has something to be celebrated. Joy is something to be asked for. I can be clothed in joy. Not ignoring emotions, not ignoring situations, but at the end of the day, I can still remain joyful. But then I write these things. Help me, Lord, so that when I see the next right thing to do, regardless of how I feel, what is the next right thing? It's amazing. I had a conversation with a parent from this week, and they were saying, it's just so crazy. Our kids go to church, but we don't. What? Which is interesting to me, and that's fine, you know. And I said, how does that? He says, well, we drop them off sometimes. I said, okay. Actually, by the way, they didn't even drop them at this church, which is, that's horrible, okay, because all the other churches stink. So I'm just saying, no, I'm just kidding, stop. So I said, how is that? How is that? And I said, man, we just don't know. We don't know. It feels weird. It feels this. For them, the next right thing is, can you just get in God's house? Because you're his son and daughter. And by the way, the one who created you, because you're his son and daughter, that's where you belong, in his house. Yeah. That's the idea. Three things when we're talking about choosing joy. I'm asking God to show me, to help me find joy in everything. I'm asking because you can pray. Let me hear the joy in the midst of my broken bones. In the middle of difficulty, in the middle of this tough situation, you've received our writings in the midst of severe suffering. Lord, show me. I got to pray. I got to find some joy here. And then, what's the next right thing? I don't know if it's forgiving someone. I don't know if it's hugging someone. I don't know if it's coming to church. I don't know if it's coming to church with your whole family. I don't know. I don't know if it's asking your kids, so when you made a decision, did you make a decision for Jesus? I don't know. What's the next right thing? We make it so complicated. That's what we're going to talk about next week. Everything is so complicated. Jesus comes, he simplifies it. He says, he just makes it simple. Love me with all your heart, mind, and soul, and all your strength. What does that mean? We'll talk about that next week. Simplify it. Just what's the next right thing? Because according to Scripture, there's something you do to have joy. What's the next right thing to move the kingdom forward? Because at the chapel, we want you to know that when you make a decision to follow Jesus, when you make a decision to follow Christ, things aren't perfect. Sometimes things get worse before they get better, but they always end up getting better when you're next to and in the presence of the one who's created you. Amen? We love you guys. Bow your heads. Let me pray for you. Thank you, Lord, so much. Lord, thank you that we have the freedom, Lord, to come into your house, to learn from your word and hear your voice from your word. Lord, thank you for the privilege it is, Lord, to serve families in a community with the light and the message of your gospel. With everyone just sitting in their seat, very simply, I just want to say a blessing over you and your children. May the God who is immeasurably able to do more than you could ever ask or imagine, may he bless you. May he watch over you. May he protect you. Where your feet take you, may he go before you. May he make himself more known to you this week than ever before. May he give you the strength and the power to live the way and behave the way and speak the way he created us to live. By his voice, through his word, may he bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We love you guys. Hey, listen, let's stand together.